If that's your prayer, and just be an open vessel right now and say, Lord, I'm open. You promised. I'm receiving. Would you do it right now? Lord, I need your touch. I need your presence. I need the hope that only you can give and the joy that only you fill us with and the power and presence of your Spirit. Father, I bless you and thank you and honor you today. What a joy it is to be in your presence. That in your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. We just receive. We're open vessels. We thank you that you've made our bodies the temple of the Holy Spirit just to come and fill us and flood us and meet and minister to every part of us. We thank you for your presence today. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Look at the people on the screen, if you will, that we're praying for, and let us continue to pray that God is going to touch and minister and move in all of their lives. As you know, we're praying for the Anthony J. family. His father passed away. I'll say more about that in just a moment, but we're praying for their family today in the passing of his father, and all of these needs, they're very urgent. As we read them, as we look at them today, asking God to touch and minister in their lives. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. How many of you would say, Pastor, I need a healing today? And in this prayer time right now, as we pray for one another, that's one of the main reasons we do come to church, is to pray for one another. Let's pray and receive today our healing, our miracle, our need met. Let's do it now. Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your promises. We thank you for your word is true. Lord, we know that you love us with an inestimable worth today, that you gave your very life for us, and with your stripes we were healed. We know that you give to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. And you said that you give to us freely all things to enjoy. And we bless you for that and honor you in that. And I'm asking you, Lord, to heal and minister to your people. I'm praying today that we would take the limits off, that we would not allow doubt or fear or anything at all keep us from receiving the blessing, our need met, your healing, your strength, your comfort in this service. We lift up our family, our church family, and our friends. We're asking you to heal mightily today for your glory, for your praise, for a testimony that you alone are the Lord of our lives. And we'll give you the praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you just, with your hands raised, would you just say, thank you, Lord, for your blessings in my life, for all blessings, those spiritual blessings that the Christ of Calvary and the empty tomb and the ascension and at the right hand ever living to make intercession has blessed us with in heavenly places with this morning. We thank you for those blessings. We receive them and give you glory for them in Jesus' name. Amen. Good to see you this morning in the house of the Lord. Everybody that's here, all guests that might be here, glad that you're here. You may be seated. What a joy it is to be in the presence of the Lord today. I want to just give you an announcement. We'll get this out in a telephone tree either this afternoon or in the morning. But the services for Anthony J's father, who passed away yesterday, visitation will be tomorrow night at Ron Hall's from 6 to 8. 6 to 8 tomorrow evening, Monday evening. And then the funeral service at Ron Hall's chapel at 11 o'clock Tuesday. Again, we'll get a phone tree out for you today. Please be in prayer for the J family. Before I give even the graphic to three ways to give, and you can see it on the screen already, I just want to say we're excited about going to camp meeting tonight. We got the 15-passenger van out there. It's all cleaned up, and it's going to be cool, and it's going to be a great drive. And we've got room for about four more. If you haven't let me know yet, you let me know. First come, first serve. But we've got room for about four more, and we're going to save a little room to take our lawn chairs. And if you're driving over to Tifton tonight, maybe you're just driving, this is from the state office. Dress comfortably, casually, and cool, because it's going to be outside in a tent. And because they're expecting such a massive crowd, said it might be a good idea for you to bring a lawn chair, just in case. I think they got about 2,000 plus chairs there, inside and outside the tent, but you might want to remember that. So I hope you can go over. It's going to be a great night of worship together. Kim and I are looking forward to driving over in the group that we're going with in the van. So God bless you as you remember that. So you see the ways to give. Thank you so very much for your generosity, your church. You're helping the ministries greatly inside and outside the ministries of this church. Let's plug into this week's announcements. Turn your attention to the screen and see what's going on here at Vidalia Church of God.
Good morning, and welcome to Vidalia Church of God. We are so thankful you have decided to worship with us. If you're a guest with us today, we are so glad you're here. For us, church is much more than just a Sunday service, and we want you to feel at home here. One of the best ways to get connected is to fill out the Connect card on the pew in front of you, scan the QR code on the back of the bulletin you just received, or visit our webpage at vidaliachurch.org and click Connect in the top right corner. After the service, take the card to the Welcome Center so we can give you a small token of our appreciation. We look forward to seeing you at the next service.
Next Sunday, June 12th, Dr. Dan Tomlin will be our guest in the morning service. We look forward to having Dr. Tomlin with us. Say hello to summer by joining your girlfriends Thursday night, June 16th at 6:30 at the home of Corey Wickson. Your meal will be provided. Bring your lawn chairs to enjoy a night of relaxing by the pool. Please RSVP on the church website. Saturday, June 18th, everyone that works with our children are asked to be here for a CPR certification class. Class starts at 10 a.m. and will conclude at 12. See Pastor Merritt with any questions you may have. How many remembers Tribe Wars 2021? If you do, you remember this. This year, it promises to be even better. Kids of all ages need to be here every Wednesday night at 6:30 p.m. You don't want to miss a single minute of fun.
We had a blast last year during Kids Crusade, and this year will not disappoint either. Who said a little slime ever hurt anybody? Not us. We want this year to be bigger and better, but we can't do it without you. If you are willing to volunteer, please let Pastor Brandy know. This is going to be a great year.
Okay, girlfriends, our annual weekend retreat is coming up August the 12th through the 14th. This year, we will be at the Stanley Southern Traditions here in Toombs County. Cost of the weekend is $150. Your $100 deposit is due by July 1st. Put your deposit in an envelope and mark it retreat.
You can stay up to date with all of our church events by following our social media platforms.
Those are the announcements for the week, but should you need Pastor Merritt or the staff, give us a call. Phone numbers are in your bulletin. And most of all, we look forward to seeing you at the next service. Have a good week.
Why don't you go ahead and stand with us again, if you will.
There is a shaking, let hearts awaken. Our God is moving, forever changing.
Oh, If the altar's where you meet us, take me there, take me there. If what you need is just an offering, I'm right here, my life is here, and I'll be a living sacrifice for you. You're a fire, the refiner. I wanna be consumed. I wanna be tried by fire. Purified, you take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I wanna be tried by fire. Purified, you take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life.
If your glory wants to come in, let it fall. Want it all, your fire is consuming. Feel this place, set it ablaze, and I'll be a living sacrifice for you. You're a fire, the reviver. I wanna be consumed. I wanna be tried.
Thank you that you do a personal work in each of our lives today. We've come to worship you today, to gather in this place, to meet with you, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you promised that you would be here for us and with us. And we receive all of your fullness today. We give you all the glory for the work of your grace that you're going to do in and through our lives, in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Turn around and greet some people, would you, before you're seated. God bless your hearts. It's good to see all of you in the house of worship today. It's good to be in the house of worship today. I want to preach today on this Pentecost Sunday on Pentecost. What does it mean? And today, on the Jewish calendar and on the Christian calendar, this is commemorated. But Pentecost is more than a day that we commemorate. Pentecost is a dynamic that we experience. Pentecost is more than just a denominational group. But Pentecost is a power for living in our lives. As a matter of fact, the outstanding Methodist missionary, E. Stanley Jones, made the statement. He said, Pentecost is not a luxury. It is a divine necessity for the human living. He said, unless Pentecost or the Holy Spirit fills, the human spirit fails. We're shut up to the alternative. It is Pentecost or failure. And when I talk about Pentecost today, that's where I'm going in this message of what it really means to understand Pentecost then and now. We turn our hearts to Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And we get this unveiling for us of what Pentecost truly means. The Bible says in Acts 2 and 1, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together, that was the 120 disciples of the Lord Jesus, in one place. Now, biblically and historically, Pentecost was one of the three annual pilgrimage feasts for the nation of Israel. It was preceded by Passover. Passover, when the Exodus was commemorated. And then 50 days later was this feast of Pentecost. And then it preceded the third and final annual pilgrimage feast that was required of the people to return back to the city of Jerusalem to come to, and that was the Feast of Tabernacles. And this Feast of Pentecost was Shavuot in the Hebrew. It was known as the Feast of Weeks and the Feast of First Fruits. The Feast of Weeks because it was 7 weeks from Passover. The scripture says in Leviticus 23, when it gives us these three feasts, that from you're to count from yourself 7 Sabbaths, 7 weeks, 49 days plus 1 day. And you are to celebrate, commemorate the harvest, the spring harvest. Now, this week of feasts was very important in Israel. It was very necessary that they understood the reasons, the terminology that God was given to them in this feast. But they came back to Jerusalem after Passover 50 days. It was celebrated on Sunday, the first day of the week. Actually, it started at the sundown on the Sabbath yesterday, and it would go through Monday. But it was celebrated first on that first day of the week. Then the Feast of First Fruits, it was known as that because the worshipers would come back to Jerusalem bringing the first ripened grains of wheat with them into the city. I see it as a great celebration feast. I mean, it's not like the others weren't, but it was a time of great joy. They came testifying that the Lord was their provision. Give us this day our daily bread. Our dependence is upon you. Our future is upon you, not just for natural bread, material bread, but also spiritual bread. For man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. And so it was a celebration. It was called the Feast of First Fruits because they brought back these ripened heads of wheat, and it was a great time of celebration as they baked the bread and they gave sacrifice to the Lord in the city together. Then finally, Pentecost Shavuot for the Old Testament Israelites commemorated the giving of the Torah, the law, that God gave to Moses on Mount Sinai. Now, it too was 50 days after Passover. You remember when they applied the blood of the lamb to the doorpost in Egypt, and they marched out that night in mighty power and mighty hand. 50 days from that day, very significant, that God called Moses up on Mount Sinai, and he gave him the law. He gave him the Torah, we call it. And the Lord demonstrated there supernaturally with fire coming down from heaven on that mountain. His voice spoke. There was a great shaking, and it demonstrated that God was saying to Israel, I am with you, I am among you, I am supernaturally going to do a work in your midst. So every year, pilgrims from all over the diaspora would come back to Jerusalem, Jews and converts to Judaism, and they would come up the mountain into Mount Zion in the city of David, and they would sing the songs of ascent. They would gather there with all the residents in Jerusalem, and they would sing the songs of ascent like, I was glad when they said to me, let us come to the house of the Lord. Are you glad to be here today on this Pentecost Sunday with that great fulfillment that it brings into our lives? And there was singing and there was gladness. But I want you to get the picture. When you see Acts 2 and 1, you have to get this picture that over in the temple area, there was great preparations being made on that Sunday, on Pentecost Sunday, Shavuot. The priests were getting the sacrifices ready. They were baking the bread. They could have leaven in the bread and fine flour. There was a wonderful meal prepared with dairy, which was not like Passover, where there was unleavened bread. And all of that was in preparation as they were preparing all of that great celebration that day. They would lay out the scrolls of the Torah, and they would read the Ten Commandments. And the book of Ruth would be read at the temple courts, because Ruth represented the harvest, and it was kindness and gladness. And it's all commemorative of everything that would be going on that was signified on this day. But about 3/4 of a mile from the temple, you go down past Caiaphas, the high priest's house, and you walk up some stairs, and there's a guest chamber. We call it the upper room. It is no doubt the same upper room that Jesus, on the night of that last Passover, when he celebrated with his disciples before he went to the cross, that he said, this is my body and my blood that is shed for you. This Passover is the new covenant, because I am your Passover, and it's being fulfilled. It's the same upper room where he took off his outer garments and washed his disciples' feet and showed them that he came to be the servant unto salvation for us all. It's that same upper room that after he was crucified and he came back on that first Sunday from a grave, he met with his disciples and he walked in there and he breathed on them and he said, I want you to receive the Holy Spirit. It's in this same upper room that these 100 very common, very ordinary, in many of the religious views, very uneducated, though they've been very educated, they've been with Jesus. You can't be with Jesus 3.5 years and not be educated. But monolingual, just fishermen and tax collectors, wives and women that served Jesus in his ministry, they had all gathered, a very inauspicious group compared to the masses, to the thousands that had gathered over at the temple. Now, 50 days was very significant to them too, to these disciples, because it had been 50 days since Jesus was crucified, the Passover lamb. And 50 days, 40 of those days, he had spent with them. He had showed himself alive to them by many infallible proofs. He had taught them things concerning the kingdom. He had commanded them to take this gospel to a waiting world, that the Savior has done the work. Salvation has come. But he said to them, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. Wait in the city of Jerusalem until you are clothed upon with power from on high. For John truly baptized you with water, but you will be baptized not many days from now with the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says that he said, now you will receive power when this Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. And so from the time that he ascended, 40 days, 10 more days, there they were. They were in obedience to his command. The apostles were there, Peter and James and John and Bartholomew and Nathanael and Philip and Thomas and Judas, not Iscariot, and James, the son of Alphaeus, and on and on. And the women were there, the women that had ministered him. No doubt Mary Magdalene was there, and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, who had been overshadowed by the Holy Spirit and brought forth the Messiah himself. She was there. His half-brothers were there, who had not previously believed on him, but after the resurrection and between Pentecost, they had come to believe and know that their brother, their half-brother, was indeed the Messiah. And they were all in that place, in that upper room, praying and seeking God and praising God. Now, while the masses are all around the temple gathered there, and the 120 are in that upper room, three quarters of a mile away, inauspicious, it happened. The Bible says, look at it, Acts chapter 2, verse 2. I'll let you see it for yourself. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. It's like each of them had a personal, each of those 120 had a personal power station of fire resting on their head. And all of them, watch this, were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. If there's ever been a time and a day that we need again to hear a sound from heaven, it's in this day. In a day where there is such upheaval like I have never seen in all of my lifetime, such uncertainty, such searching for truth, and when our sons and our daughters are asking, what is truth, and where can I find fulfillment, and where can I find meaning in life? If there's ever been a day that our world needed to hear the message that Jesus saves and there's hope for the world again, it's in the day that you and I are living in. And I'm praying that we would hear a sound from heaven, not just this morning. I'm praying for that this morning, but that we would hear a sound from heaven in our hearts and in our lives that sets our hearts and our lips ablaze with the blessings of God, the proclamation of the word of the Lord, the Spirit of God filling us and flowing out of us to a waiting world that's needing what God does for us in the Holy Spirit. Amen? So, when all this happened, the attention that was over in the temple, all of a sudden, it paled in comparison. All those rituals and all those ceremonies that was taking place over there, there's a sound, and all of a sudden, these people are coming out of an upper room, 120 of them, and they look visibly shaken. Are appearing under a manifestation. They're speaking in languages that these common monolingual people don't know, but we know them because the Bible says that they were all there from, there were those from Persia, There were those Medes. There were those from Cappadocia and Pamphylia, and there were Jews and Jewish converts. There were those from Rome. There were those who were residents of Mesopotamia. There were those there from Libya, down in Africa, near Cyrene. They were there from all over the diaspora. They were there from all over the known world, converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. And while they heard these people, these 120 speaking the wonderful works of God, the praises of God that they didn't know in language, they understood in their own language. And it was just an amazing thing to these people that had gathered, thousands of them looking and wondering. And the Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse 12, amazed and perplexed. What is this? What does it mean, they're asking? They were said, what is going on? We've never seen anything like it. We've done the rituals, and it's a festive day. We're enjoying our holiday here at Pentecost. We've never seen anything like the manifestation that we're seeing in us. And that's the first question I want us to look at. I'm going to ask about three questions this morning. And the first one is, what does it mean? You know, when I read this story again this weekend, my mind went back to 1987 when I was, Kim and I were in Jerusalem touring the Holy Land. We were there to go to the upper room that day. We were with a group of about 15 other pastors and ministers and wives. And our leader, Floyd Lahan, said, I hope nobody's there. When we get there, I just want the room all to ourselves. We had a little service plan. Well, when we got there, there was this huge, huge coach. Must have been 50, 60 people got off of it right in front of us going up the stairs to the upper room. Well, we were trailing along behind them, and all of a sudden we recognized that the leader of this group was one of our national evangelists, who was very well known in the Church of God movement, and he and Brother Lahan, I knew him, and we all got together. And we got in that upper room and we had a joint service. And people were being prayed for. And people were being baptized and filled with the Holy Spirit. And it was a wonderful move of God. Not that it can't happen here. I've seen it just as powerful in my sanctuaries where I've gone to church. But it was a wonderful, powerful move of God. But here's what happened. Gideon Shore, who was our Jewish God. He was not just somebody from, just trying to make a summer job. He was educated and trained in the school of the Hebrew University, and he was so knowledgeable. And he was very sensitive to the Lord, and some even wondered if he was an underground Christian. And Gideon didn't go inside the room with us, but he stood outside, and he told us this after we got on the bus, that while we were in there worshiping and praising the Lord and having our service, some high school ROTC students were walking by. They were Jewish students. They were on their way to the tomb of David. You got to get all of this in your mind, because the tomb of David is very close to the upper room. And they were on their way to the tomb of David, and they saw and heard what was going on, and they stopped. And Gideon, being a military man himself, I don't know if they made the connection or whatever, but they said to Gideon, what in this world is going on? And Gideon told them, he said, now, this upper room is very special to Christianity. It is where they believe that the Lord Jesus Christ did the Passover meal and the Last Supper. But to these particular Christians, they also believe that on the day of Pentecost, that it was this room where those 120 were filled with the Holy Spirit. And he said, this is what those ROTC, at least one or several, said to them. We don't understand this, but we know it's real. Our world is waiting on us to give them something this morning that's real. Our culture needs a language this morning that's more than, as wonderful it is, more than just a language that's vertical to God that no man can understand as we speak mysteries in the Spirit. That's wonderful. We need that. But our world needs the language of love and grace and glory. And the world is waiting on us to take to them. We don't understand it, but we know when we hear the Word of God by the Spirit of God, it's going to make an impact and a difference and draw us to the Lord Jesus. And so these are there wondering, what in this world can these common people who don't know our languages from all over the world be doing speaking this? And so Peter, he is asked, what does this mean? And as a matter of fact, he stood up in the whole assembly among the 11, and he said, let me explain. This is not what you think it is. Now, some were mocking and said, these are intoxicated with new wine. And then Peter said, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. We know that there's a visible. We know that you're hearing things and seeing things you've never seen, and it looks different to you. But these are not drunk as you think they are. And then he begins to tell them what Pentecost really means. And the first thing it meant was, prophecy from Scripture is now fulfilled. You know, how many of you remember reading in Jeremiah and Ezekiel that there was coming a day when God was going to write that Torah on our hearts? It was not going to be given to us on tablets of stone. How many of you remember reading that he was going to give to us in that day a new spirit, a new man? And you know, Peter, he could have gone from Solomon to Isaiah. He could have gone from Ezekiel to Zechariah. He could have pulled from any number of prophets to begin to tell them what this means, but he didn't. He went 24 centuries earlier to the prophet Joel, and he said, this is what this means. Acts 2 and verse 16, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel, Peter said. You want to know what this means? You want to know what's going on here in the last days? God says, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. You know, when Joel wrote this, and I think it's so significant that Peter was inspired by the Holy Spirit to give him Joel's prophecy of what this meant and what was going on and what was being fulfilled right before their very eyes. I think it's very significant because in that day, Israel was in national crisis. You'll remember reading Joel that the palmer worm and the canker worm and the locust, all kinds of locusts, had come in and denuded the land. It was a horrible time in Israel. There was famine. There was disaster. There was drought. Israel began to know what this meant. It meant that God was getting their attention because they needed to repent and turn from the Lord. They had walked away. It was a time when farmers were in perplexity. It was a time when men were addicted to wine. It was a time when people were in such consternation in that land that Joel stood up and he gave them a message from God, and he said, if you'll return to me, if you'll repent, I want you to know that I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. Oh, what a promise to America. What a promise to our families this morning. What a promise to all of us. He said, if my people who are called by my name in another place will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. I will forgive your sin and heal your land. And Joel is calling the people to return back to the Lord. He said, if you will, the Lord says, I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. I will send to you the former and the latter rain. You will be satisfied and you will never be put to shame. And the Holy Spirit, according to Joel, as Peter prophesies and quotes, that same Holy Spirit that covered the face of the waters at creation, the same Holy Spirit that came upon Bezalel and others to give them skill and knowledge and intellect to do the work of God, the same Holy Spirit that came upon Jephthah and Deborah and Samson in the camp of Dan, the same Holy Spirit that came upon the prophets to write the word of God, and David to slay Goliath and subdue kingdoms. The same Holy Spirit that enabled Elijah and Elisha to go forth in power. The same Holy Spirit that came upon Jehaziel in the days of Jehoshaphat, and there was a great miracle battle won for the people of God when they were surrounded. That same Holy Spirit, Peter is saying, has come. He is filling, and I'm telling you, the same Holy Spirit is still here today, filling our hearts so that our children and our grandchildren and those after us can know the indwelling person and presence and power of the Holy Spirit in our lives today. Amen. Peter is saying, what you're seeing is, this is, you should know all this. He wasn't being sarcastic. He just said that you're seeing it right before your eyes. This is what this meant. But then he did something else to tell them what it meant. He began to preach Jesus to them. He began to tell them about Jesus Christ. And beginning in verse 22 and following, he said, you know Jesus, you've heard of him. He was among you. He did miracles and wonders. But you with evil hands put him to death, crucifying him on the cross. But it was not possible that death could hold him. And on that third day, God raised him from the dead. And David said, I saw the Lord, who is ever before my Lord at his right hand. He said, therefore, I want you to know my soul will rest in hope, because in his presence there is fullness of joy. At his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. And Peter is beginning to tell them that there is a crucified, risen, ascended, interceding Jesus at the right hand of the Father. And this is what it means. Number two, not only is prophecy fulfilled, but it's proof positive that Jesus is alive and he is reigning this morning. You crucified him with evil hands, but it was according to the purpose and foreknowledge of God. And God had it all in his hand. He gets into this message in about verse 32 and 33 of Acts 2. When he gets down to the end, Peter says, God has raised this Jesus that I just preached to you about to life. And we are all witnesses of the fact. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. This outpouring of the Holy Spirit then and now means an empty tomb has made for an occupied throne, and an occupied throne means that we have a full heart this morning as the Holy Spirit has been poured out according to the promise that Jesus is in fact alive and well. He's not up in heaven wringing his hands wondering, what in this world am I going to do in the 21st century around this world? What has gone wrong? No, he is firmly in place. The Holy Spirit came as positive proof that Jesus sits and reigns at the right hand of the Father on high until he comes back for his children again. I don't know if you ever heard the story of Roald Amundsen. He was a great Norwegian explorer in the latter part of the 19th century, early part of the 20th century. He was the first one to discover the magnetic north at the North Pole. He had developed, being the Norwegian navigators that they were, he had developed a ship that could go over the icebergs and ice caps and without splitting the vessels, and he got there. So he was on this expedition. It was, weeks on end after he left home that he had gone on this expedition. He'd never been discovered, the North Pole. His wife was so worried before he went. She was very concerned, wouldn't you? Going to the North Pole, of all expeditions. You know, this man was a man of renown. Later, he would get a Nobel Peace Prize for his great contributions in World War I. But get back to the late 19th century, early 20th century. He is there on this expedition. And all of a sudden, one day, some say that the carrier pigeon tapped on the the windowsill. Others said the pigeon was just circling. But Amundsen had taken this carrier pigeon and assured his wife that he would turn that pigeon loose to let her know that he made it safe and sound at the North Pole. And she looked up and realized, I understand that even some of the major newspapers carried the article. She realized, my husband, this pigeon has come thousands of miles from where he was to let me know. I want to tell you, 2,000 years ago, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came. The Father sent the heavenly dove to us, that same heavenly dove that settled upon Jesus in those baptism waters when John baptized him with water, and a voice came from heaven and said, "This is my Son in whom I'm well pleased." And from that day forward, the Holy Spirit came upon him in power. That same Holy Spirit, when he came, he assured us that Jesus is every person he said he was, did everything that he said he would do. And you and I, the fact that you and I are filled with the Holy Spirit today means that Jesus is not in some incarcerated tomb, but he kicked the bottom of that tomb out. He lives, he reigns, he is ever living to make intercession. What victory we have. We should never ever see ourselves at any disadvantage. Who is he that would bring anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? It is Christ who died, who rather is risen, who is even now at the right hand of the Father, ever living to make intercession for every one of us. There's victory in this house for you today. All you need to understand is that Pentecost is that personal experience today that you can live with assurance that Jesus is in control, in charge of your life. And then just one other thing that Peter wanted them to know what this meant. It was a personal promise for our infilling. You know, the fact that Peter said, it was a personal promise for every one of us. Every one of us. Of our personal infilling. You know, he said, this is what the prophet Joel said. In the last days, says the Lord, I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters, without ethnicity restrictions, without racial restrictions, without socioeconomic restrictions, without gender restrictions, without age, young or old restrictions, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. And your old men will dream dreams. And upon my men servants and maid servants, women servants, will I pour out my spirit in those days. And they shall prophesy. And whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a promise. What a blessing this morning. Before that day was over, Peter would tell them in Acts 2:39, for the promise is for you today, 2,000 years ago, and your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. Aren't you glad that the promise is for you today? You don't have to live as orphans, Jesus said. I will come to you in my spirit. When the people heard the word preached, the Bible says they were cut in their hearts when Peter preached this message about Jesus. They were cut in their hearts. Conviction. The Holy Spirit, the first work of the Holy Spirit is to convict us and to draw us to the saving knowledge of Jesus. And as he's preaching, they began to feel that drawing. And they ask a second question. What shall we do? What shall we do this morning? And this is what Peter said. Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. What shall we do? First of all, repent. If we don't know Jesus Christ, that's the first thing. The Holy Spirit is drawing us. Jesus said when he comes into the world, he will convict the world of sin. He comes to convict. He comes not to condemn us, but to convict us, to draw us to the love and grace and salvation of our Lord, letting us know. God has said, I want you. I want you to return to me. That's the first thing Peter said you do. And the second thing is you receive. You know, all you need to do when you become a Christian is just receive the Holy Spirit by faith. I've seen people try to make it so hard. But you see, the Holy Spirit is the promise of the Father. The Holy Spirit is the gift of the Holy Spirit. How do you receive a gift? You receive a gift by faith, do you not? You just believe. Lord, I believe your promise. I believe your promise. He says, I want you to receive the Holy Spirit. Receive him as he is this morning, a gift. If you have not received the Holy Spirit, if you've not been born again, you can be. Here's the three things I just tell you here. When we're talking about what shall we do, well, we're born again of the Spirit. That's the first thing. Remember Jesus telling Nicodemus that in John 3, you must be born again. Whoever's born of the flesh is, whatever born of the flesh is flesh. Whoever's born of the Spirit is Spirit. Be born again of the Spirit of God. It's the Holy Spirit that does that work of regeneration. Just like he brooded over the waters in creation and bringing life to this earth. He brings life to us in Jesus. Amen. And then, when you and I receive the Holy Spirit, we bear the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Just like those first fruits were brought, all of a sudden we start bearing the fruit of Jesus. Love and joy and peace and patience and goodness and gentleness and meekness and self-control and faithfulness. All of those fruit of the Spirit. You know, Brother Elmer, he's been coming in with his first fruits. Have y'all noticed him coming in with his first fruits? I thought about it today. He came in with two big buckets of tomatoes for somebody, bringing them in, bringing in those spring vegetables. Well, I want to tell you, the Holy Spirit wants us to bear the fruit of the harvest. To begin, that's the work of the Holy Spirit. And then to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, born again of the Spirit, bear the fruits of the Spirit, the fruit of Christ, and then to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I have so much to say here, but I'm gonna move in this to help us understand that while there's the born-again experience for every Christian, there's the baptism experience. Baptism in the Holy Spirit. For every believer, you can be baptized in the Holy Spirit. It gives you boldness to testify and witness. It gives you the language for the lost out there. It gives you courage and anointing for service. It gives you victory in spiritual warfare. You know, I'm not one of these weird preachers that sees a demon behind every flat tire. But I want you to know that spiritual warfare is real. I want you to know that there is a real devil that goes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. I want to remind you that all of us are in this fight, but I also want to remind you of Ephesians 6 and 10. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against all the devices of the devil. For we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, against each other, but we wrestle against principalities and powers, against spiritual darkness, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And he said, I want you to take unto you the whole armor of God. Then he said in verse 18, praying on all occasions in the Spirit. I want to tell you today, we've got weapons of our warfare that we stand in victory through this morning. We are not defeated by the devil. For 1 John 4 and 4 says, greater is the one who is in you, the Holy Spirit of God, than the one who is out there in that world. But what power What authority? And then one final question. How shall we live? How shall we live? What does this mean? What shall we do? And how shall we live? And I just want to tell you, live in love. What does Pentecost look like? I love the exuberance. I love the joy. I love the shouting and all of the demonstrations. But I want to tell you, Pentecost really looks like a brother or sister going to another brother or sister and said, you know, I hurt you. I want you to forgive me. It looks like love. And when we get in our spirits and we get condemning and judgmental and we're just, I don't know, but just things aren't right and we get critical, and I want to tell you, we may need a new baptism in the Holy Spirit and get baptized all over again in love. It makes you love everybody, amen? How many of you remember when you got saved and you got filled with the Holy Spirit? What love filled our hearts? Romans 5:5, the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit that He's given to us. And then just one other thing, we need to live with joy. Joy. How long has it been since you would say, Pastor, I really sense that deep, settled joy in my heart. But when you were baptized in the Holy Spirit, as a matter of fact, the Bible says in Acts 13:52 that the disciples, this is Acts 13:52, this is years later, that they were filled with the Holy Spirit and with joy, or with joy in the Holy Spirit. He's a byproduct this morning. Joy. How long has that been since you've really, really experienced that joy of the Lord? As Romans 14:17, it's not the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but it's a matter of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That joy that David talked about, my cup runs over. That joy that Isaiah talked about, therefore with joy shall you draw water from the wells of salvation. That joy that Jesus talked about, these things I've told you, He said that my joy will be in you and your joy will be full. That joy that Paul talked about when he said, don't be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking to yourselves in hymns and songs and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord. I just want to call us back this morning as I close this service to let's let the joy of Pentecost fill our hearts and our minds and our lives one more time. Whatever we've allowed to try to replace that joy with the happiness of the world and with things and this and the other, that we would say, Lord, I found something worth living for. It's you. You know, I remember as a boy, we would sing a song. You'll remember it, most of you. I have found a joy no tongue can tell, how its waves of glory roll. It's like a great or flowing well springing up within my soul. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, and the half has never been told. Peter said, it is joy unspeakable. That joy, that's your strength. I'm not talking about some kind of joy that's impervious to hurt. You know, it's joy when you're at the top of your game and everything's great and all the bills are paid and you're doing good and you're still, joy of the Lord is your strength, and that's who you look to and that's where your source and satisfaction is. But it's not a denial of the hurts and the sorrows and the reality that we go. And we can be like Peter and John when they walked out of that Sanhedrin court after having been persecuted. The Bible says they lifted their hands and they rejoiced that they were able to suffer shame for His name. I'm talking about a joy that supersedes anything that's happening to us down here. Jesus said, just simply come to me. And whoever comes to me, as it is written, out of his inmost being will flow rivers of living water. Are the rivers flowing this morning? If they're not, they can. We can take off everything that impedes that and just let the joy and the love of God flow in our lives. Stand with me, would you please? Would you lift your hands to heaven? Would you just lift them to the Lord today? Would you thank God that you know the meaning of Pentecost? If you do, if you don't know Jesus, you can today. He's waiting. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord, he said in this passage, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's what Pentecost means to you today. Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of your sin. You can be free and free indeed today. Just lift your hands, church, all over the building and begin to thank the Lord for the Holy Spirit personally in you today, in your own life, in your own being, in your own experience today. Would you right now just begin to thank Him for that love and that joy that He's given to you in your hearts? Lord, we just thank You today and we praise You. I bless You and I honor You. I glorify You. Church, would you give Him praise? Or are you thankful today for His presence in your life? Are you thankful today that you can experience Him in fullness of joy this morning, regardless of what's going on? I do. I really do. And you know, it would really, in a day that we're living in, it would be for us like it was in the day of Joel to hear the Lord say, just return to Me with fasting and return to Me with prayer and expectancy. Just return to Me and I'll restore to you everything. I'll restore joy and I'll restore fullness. And I'll restore to you greater than you've ever imagined before. Maybe it's for us today to get to that place in our own hearts and lives that we say, Lord, I need a fresh baptism in the Holy Spirit. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, He's waiting right now to just come in and forgive your sin and give you life as though you never committed a sin. Give you the assurance of eternal life in heaven. Start you on a road of abundant living like you've never known. Just call on the Lord right now. Say, Lord, I'm coming to You. You're my Savior. If you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, you don't have to beg and plead. Peter said, you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Just open up your heart and say, Lord, fill me. I'm ready today. Fill me, Holy Spirit. Would you do that right now? If you've never been baptized in the Holy Spirit, if you've never experienced this Acts 2:4, when they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit, you can have that wonderful power and experience to change your life and change those around you today. Just receive Him. For those of us that have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, how often do we read where we hear that we can be filled again and again and refreshed and renewed? And I thank God for Him and His presence today. Father, I just ask You, Lord, as we stand here with our hands lifted, that You would do a work individually and purposefully in each of our lives, personally for us today. Lord, that we would receive today in this service, that we would receive. I just sense You're receiving this morning, many of you. I pray You won't allow anything to distract You, because I do believe if there's any time we need to hear again a sound from heaven and we need to see the work of God is in this day that we're living in, but it's up to us to receive. As Terry and the praise team sings the final chorus, I'm going to ask you to come from where you're standing. If you're comfortable doing that, would you come and fill this altar area with me right now as they sing this chorus? We're going to fill this altar area. Come receiving this morning. Yes, and just sing this as a prayer. Spirit, come in my own heart. Right where you're standing, if you are not coming, you can receive the Holy Spirit. You can receive a freshness of His presence and power and grace in your life. Just come in close and let's worship Him today. Let's sing it with the praise team together. Yes, Lord, fall on us, outpour again. God of rest today. Pentecost.
Sweet Holy Spirit, Spirit of all, follow me.
I'm going to ask you to lay your hand on the shoulder of the person that's standing nearest to you before we go this morning. And I'm just going to ask us to receive a fresh infilling. Our children, our grandchildren, the people we work with, the people who we live beside, oh, how they need our witness today of joy and love and the message of Christ and the cross living out in us and through us. Would you just begin to pray for one another? You know, sometimes they laid their hands on the disciples and they were filled. Sometimes they just spoke the word and they were filled. Sometimes they would just say, receive the Holy Spirit, and they were filled. It's not a magical formula, but the most important thing is receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the promise of the Father. Let Him refresh us again today in this service, from the back of the sanctuary to the front altars here. Let's begin to receive, Father. We need you. We need your Spirit. We need your power today. Oh God, move among us. Refresh us. Touch us, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray we would have a hunger again. I pray we would have a thirst again. I pray, Lord Jesus, that we would sense that deep joy that's unspeakable and full of glory. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. We praise you, God. Receive today, move in our midst, touch us, refresh us, reignite us today. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, the Lord, I will so rest in the command. Move the ministry of God in our midst, Lord. We need your touch, Lord. We need your presence. We need your power. Oh, worshiping church, would you just give Him praise? Hallelujah, give Him worship today, give Him glory today. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Spirit, we receive you fresh and anew today. We give you glory, we give you praise in this house. We give you glory and we give you praise in this place. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, the world is looking for something different. They don't know what they're looking for, but they're looking for fulfillment and meaning and truth like never before. Just lift up your hands and thank God that you can be that vessel to your children and grandchildren and the people you work with, that they can see Christ in you and in me. Father, we thank you today for the Holy Spirit. We thank you for the move of the Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for the shaking of the Holy Spirit in our own lives, that the world will take notice that we've been with you, Jesus. Something different about us, something joyful and something full of love and peace about us. And we give you praise for it. We give you glory for it. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Turn around and greet some people, would you, before you go. Let them know that you love them. In Jesus' love today. God bless your heart.